It's an honor for me to be here to my first speech as a doctor in philosophy. I was in the other world. I was in the business sector in the past. When I was a little boy, very young, my passions were chess and philosophy. But because my family belong in business, I cannot mention that because they will kill me. But then I keep this in my heart, inside me, and just go to the traditional career as economist. I study engineer, I study in Harvard, LSE, everything. But I don't feel happy because I want to play chess and I want to study philosophy. Then when I was adult, I read a book of Powell and Berger, and they said in the prologue, they mentioned a French writer, novelist from century 19, that he said when you, in the adult, decide to go to your dreams that you have when you are young, is the moment that you start to be happy. Then I decide to quit many things and start to play chess amateur very badly, but also study philosophy. I started a PhD in philosophy. It was not easy because it's another world, no? Well, then Judy asked me to try to make a speech today about relationship between chess and happiness. And maybe the question that we have to set is that can the chess player achieve happiness? To try to understand this relationship, we have to try to define what happiness means. I just put some philosopher, because we can put many others, just to say that if we ask here who want to be happy, everyone will say, yes, I want to be happy. But if we start to ask what happiness means, it's a big problem, because philosophers think something, economists associate happiness with well-being, Buddha, religious, different, etc. I just put some philosopher, classical, like Pythagoras. Pythagoras, as you know, was the first philosopher in the ancient Greek that mentioned the word philosophy. And they asked him, what means philosophy? And he said, okay, try to understand the wise, try to love the wise, etc. But also happiness. And they asked what happiness means to Pythagoras. Well, great, as you know, was a great mathematician. And he said, when you put together the initial with the ending, and you make a cycle, because he was very good in maths, you start to be happy. Well, in chess, you have the end, the opening, you have the ending, everything's like this. But doesn't mean that you are happy when you play chess. It's a question, because sometimes you suffer too much. Maybe it's pleasure. Then you have another, I will mention the last one, Epicurus, that associates happiness with pleasure, just pleasure. Maybe you can associate this in many aspects of life. For Socrates, you know, he was the one that said, I only know the fact of my ignorance. I only know that I don't know nothing. I say that related with chess because you have to be humble, because sometimes you overestimate your position and you think that you know everything and you never have to overreact with the position. Then it's some relationship. I don't want to go very deep in each philosopher. I just want to come back to Aristotle, because my thesis was in Aristoteles. Also, you have Plato. For Plato, justice is very related with happiness. It means in chess, the rules are for everybody the same. It's a fair game. Then it's very related with this. But let's go to Aristotle. It's the main topic. For Aristotle, I would try to apply very briefly the theory of Aristotle to chess in some way. It's something I'm trying to research. And it's not easy to talk about that. For Aristotle, happiness is the final good of each human. He can say that power, money, status can give some happiness. But at the end of the day, you go to those for something, maybe for happiness. Or you don't go to power, to money, or to status just for itself. You make for something. You want to have money for something. You have to be status for something. But Aristotle observed in Greek, in the ancient Greek, that all the human have a final good, and this is happiness, is the more perfect good. And then each action is supposed to go to the final good, and this must be the perfect good. It's difficult to understand the relationship, but at the end of the day, the important thing is that the ultimate goal is happiness. This is the more perfect good. How we apply this to chess? Well, the concept of mesote, is the action when you make some action in life, in any aspect of your life, in business, in love, in chess, whatever, and it's not the mathematical meal of 2 points. It's the action that put your soul in peace and you feel good. Means that must not be in the middle. In chess, when you have the time control, you have many candidate moves. And here a grandmaster, they can explain better than me this. But at the end of the day, you have to choose one action. You have to choose one decision. And you cannot go so deeply forever because you have the time control. This also very related with when Aristotle mentioned that you need contemplative to be happy, like a Buddha, but also you need activity. You cannot be happy just with contemplation, everything. You have to be also action. And in chess, you have to make a move in the time control. You have to analyze different actions to go and then press the clock. Then means that you have to be prudent, that you have to apply this mesote concept of Aristotle. If every time in your life, for every action, every game. Well, in chess, we must apply the virtue of mesote completely. We must balance between our deep analysis and our strategic move, and we don't use the mathematical medium, as I mentioned. We just use our soul decision. But it's true, you will say, okay, but it's very utopic, because when you play chess, you are not thinking in this. Well, the point is the following. As I mentioned, you have to have the balance between contemplative and practical things to try to be balanced. Like in life, you need to make both. But let's see this picture. I was very lucky to meet Boris in German, and we come to, I was so fortunate to be with him all around the world, not to many countries. We went to many places around, and I tried to say, Boris, please help me in chess. I learned from Boris more than chess about life, because he told me, Daniel, you don't have the class. I don't know what to do with you, because you don't have the class. And he shouted me all the time. And in Dubai, we spent 20 days with him in Dubai, and he was very upset with me. Daniel, I don't know what to do. We can be friends, but I cannot teach you chess because you don't have the class. Okay, Boris, but I don't mind. I really love him as a brother. I said, as a father. No, as a brother, he said. Well, he teach me about to be prudent when you make a move and never underestimate the opponent. Because sometimes when you play with open, you underestimate the open. It's the worst situation. He helped me to understand. And I can apply this concept not only in chess, in life. When you have to make a move, you have to be prudent. You have to analyze every alternative. Aristotle thinks that to be happy, you have to subordinate the external goods, the material things, everything to the soul. Then you will find happiness. You cannot apply this concept of chess because in chess, the real goal is to make checkmate. Nothing to do with happiness. But if we make an analogy, we can say that we apply this concept of Aristotle of prudence, frenesy, the same that Bori teaches to me, you can apply in other fields. But when you play serious chess and practical all the time, you can learn this concept of prudence. And then you can go to your real life and apply to business, apply to love, apply to relationship, to friendship, everything. Everything that is in the book of ethics, Nicomachea, in Aristotle, you can apply. But it seems to me, we can discuss this, we don't have time to discuss today, because it's something I try to make research. You can say, okay, but when you are playing a game, you just want to destroy the opponent and to make the final good. You are not thinking in happiness. And when you make a blunder, you don't feel happy at all. You feel very sadness. But the important things to me, that is the practice consistently, seriously, in chess, you can create these virtues, the good virtues, to try to apply them in life. This is what so far I have to discuss with you. Then, I have a lot grateful to Boris. I was recently in Moscow, visit him, and he gave me his chessboard and signed his, I said, Daniel, I have some hope, because sometimes you make some good move, but normally, I'm very disappointed. Okay, I said, but I really learned from him a lot, and I think it's very connected with the theory of Aristotle, what he really helped me. I think he's a very wise guy, and I really love him. For that reason, I put this picture of him. Now, conclusion is what I said before. That we cannot think that happiness is the final good in chess, but to make conclusion, because I don't want to extend my time here, I think it's the process in the game. You pass for good moment, bad moment, it's like this, you know, make a good move, good combination, you feel happy. You make a blunder, you lose a piece, you feel sadness. It's like in life, you feel happy. It's a balance in life. Life at the end could be a draw because you have good moments, bad moments. But at the end of the day, the important thing is that enjoy the game, try to do your best, and try to apply this principle. And I think all the practice of chess can we apply in the real life to be a better person, to be happy in the real life, trying to apply this concept and these things. I don't think it's I can say for the moment too much, because I don't know too much. As Socrates say, I only know that I don't know. Thank you very much.